time to get our services started. There'll probably be others coming as the service progresses on. But we're glad you're here this morning and to this Lord's Day, and to be able to come and give honor and glory unto Him and what He has done for you this past week. And this is a new week starting. And I want to as most of you probably know by now, if you've been watching the news, reading the news, seeing the news, we'll be going into a lockdown on Thursday. And that means we'll not be able to be meeting here at church. We'll still be live streaming on Sunday morning, as we have been. We'll also be live streaming on Wednesday night. Brother Paul, on his Genesis study, we'll be doing that. And of course, we're doing it now for the next month. That's just 4 weeks. So we'll not having mums and tots. We'll not be having the ladies' Bible study. Those things are put back for a bit right now until we're finished down to here till the 2nd of December. And so, but please just realize that. Pray for one another. Keep in contact with one another. Let them know everything is all right with you. We want to know how your lives are. And so things will be a little bit different now. But remember, till today, we have our services this morning. Have services tonight. Brother Keith McHenry's preaching for us tonight. And so we're glad to see Brother Keith back into the pulpit too. He always does a good job according to the Lord. And so just to let you know, it also means there's no bonfire. So there's no fireworks. So we just have to just realize everything that happens. Just do what needs to be done. And praise the Lord for it. We have life. And we still have it more abundantly in the Lord Jesus Christ. So just remember all those things that are going on at the moment in time. Remember to pray for one another. We need to pray for one another. Need to just really pray and that God, people have things going on in their lives, and people have illnesses. People have things. And so just remember people and pray for them through this time. So let's have a word of prayer before we go any farther this morning. Our dear most gracious Heavenly Father, Lord, as we come to you this morning, we thank you. We thank you for the opportunities we have and the opportunity of being here this morning to honor and glorify you. We thank you that we can just gather together. And Lord, I know that we're coming to another part of life of 2020. And Lord, I ask that you be with each and every one of us and our needs. Lord, I ask you to be with those right now even who are just still struggling. They're struggling through these difficult times. And I ask you, Father, that you will just bless them. I ask you to be with Maureen. Just be with her life, Lord. Just be with her and her needs and her health. Be with Rita. We're glad to hear that she is doing better. We ask that you just be with her and continue to bless her and just watch over her. Lord, just be with all those who are not able to come to be with us. And Lord, we could talk about that. But God, you know their lives. You know their needs. And if I ask you, Lord, now you just be with us today. Just bless us. Just encourage us. Just uplift us. Lord, just may your Holy Spirit truly rule and reign. And Lord, may your Spirit just permeate this place this morning, that God will just be glad to be in the house of God. And Lord, I thank you for the day. Thank you for loving us. For in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Also, there's some, back there, some daily breads that start in December. There's a few of them back there. If you need one, be sure to pick one up before you leave this morning. All right, I think that's all the notices I have at this moment in time. And for our speaker this morning, where did he go? Oh, there he is. He moved on me. Brother Williams has come and preach for us this morning. God bless you, Brother Williams.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Open your Bibles to the book of 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy. Second And we're in chapter 4, 2 Timothy chapter 4. We're going to read the first 5 verses. Verse 1, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word, be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth, and shall be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure afflictions, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. Struggling my words this morning. I've been talking too much, I've been teaching at the college. Let's have a time of prayer. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this time now, and once again we open up your word. Even in these dark circumstances that we find ourselves in, Lord, we still have this freedom where we can come into your church, and we thank you for that, Lord. And Lord, we just ask that we make the most of it. Lord, as your word is preached, that you speak to us, and Lord, that our hearts and our minds will be receptive of what you have to say today, Lord. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
As some of you know, I build lanterns. That's what I do for a living. Those old traditional lanterns you see outside of hotels and restaurants and churches and pubs and what have you. And I feel really privileged to do that. It's a craft, it's an art. And we have our standard range of lanterns, don't we? I'm not doing a pitch here. We're trying to sell really lanterns. But those, you know, you make them all the time. They become the run of the mill. We make them pretty much every day. But my job is to make bespoke ones and to create replica lanterns. So someone will send me a drawing, I've got a design to work from, and I'll build a lantern compared to the drawing. And sometimes I even have the privilege of designing one for the customer. But often we have replicas coming where an old lantern will come in and they want us to make this lantern. They want us to replicate and make an exact copy in some cases, especially when it comes to the railway people. They like things exact, absolutely precise, and if you're out in the slightest, they'll send it back. So we have to make sure that it's perfect. Sometimes we have lanterns that are like 100 years old, sometimes over that. They're sent from a church. I really like doing the church lanterns because it feels as if I'm doing something for the Lord. But when you look at the lanterns, and we create lanterns, we want the outside to look good. You know, we want the finish to look nice, and so the solder is all neat. When we send it off to be polished and lacquered or painted, we want to make sure that the finish is really nice. But when we get these older lanterns that come in, obviously they look very tatty because they're aged. They've got cobwebs. Sometimes we've had wasps' nests in them and all sorts of things. And it's my job to clean them all out and have a look inside. And when we look inside, when we tend to build the lanterns, we tend not to worry too much about the inside, because no one's ever going to see that apart from the guy that climbs up the ladder once every 2 years to change the bulb. But we look at some of these lanterns that are like over 100 years old, and you can see that the person who made the lantern took care. Not only on the outside, he was really bothered about what the inside looked like. You've got to keep in mind, he probably knew that the person that was going to look inside of that wouldn't really care himself, but to him, the craftsperson, it was important what was on the inside. And so the inside is just as important as the outside. And it's really sort of like an attitude. When you're creating something like that, you want it to be good all round. The little details really do count. Ministry and service to God is the same. It's not only concerned with what men will see, it's what happens in the background. It's in the quiet, when no one's around. It's those little details that makes a person. It changes a person from being good to excellent. It causes a Christian from just being an average Christian to a godly one. The little details of life. And that's what God's concerned with. He's concerned with what goes on in your life. Not only publicly, but what people don't see. You know, what's not public knowledge. what really undergirds you as a Christian is what you do in quiet when nobody's around. Because that really speaks of your Christianity. And it's in this spirit, I think, that Paul is speaking to Timothy. In these five verses, he's calling him to give attention to the details of ministry, the small things of ministry, the things that count. And like I said, this is what separates people from having an excellent ministry and a good ministry. Just excelling and paying attention to small details of life. And the faithful preacher is unique because he cares for those little things, the things that make a difference. And when you get those little things right, the big things start to fall in place. And we started to look at this passage, and really it's Paul again speaking to Timothy. It's the very last chapter that is ever written in the Bible. And he's telling Timothy, look, you know, you need to be the man of God that you've been called to be. And he's speaking to him as a preacher, to a preacher. And I said last time that when we go through this passage and it's given us qualities of what a good preacher is, what a good leader is, you can't switch off. Because it's your responsibility to hold the preacher to that faithfulness of Scripture. It's your responsibility to make sure that the preacher is living up to those standards. And like we've said all the way through the books of Timothy, is that the preacher is just the example for all to follow anyway. In your own life, you should be living up to these qualifications. So Paul in these verses gives us eight essentials of ministry that Timothy needs to keep. And the first one we looked at last time, it's in verse 1. I'll just quickly go over it and then we'll move on to number 2 and 3 today at least. He says, this I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. And so the first verse, we saw the seriousness of Christian service. The seriousness is that one day we're all going to stand before God. And you remember we spoke about it last time, that when we stand before a court, the judge has to try to understand what's going on, you know, who's this person? And the witnesses come in and give information about that individual, and that's all that the judge has to go on. What's on paper, what the witnesses say. But that ain't the case with God, because God knows every detail of our life, every minuscule bit of our life he has a record about. And so he's saying that this is serious. That's why he says, I charge thee before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing in his kingdom. He's going to judge us. And so it's a serious commission. And Timothy then is serving all the time in the presence of one that will render a verdict on his ministry. It's not just so Paul can be pleased. It's not just so the Ephesian church can be happy with him. It's what goes on behind the scenes, because it's what God thinks that matters. It's what God thinks about your life that matters, not what anybody else thinks. And so our second point, I want to talk about the content of his commission. And it's in verse 2. We probably know this verse very well. You've heard it many times. It says, preach the word, be instant in season and out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and doctrine. It's a passage that we preachers quote to each other all the time, especially the older preachers to the younger ones. Just letting them know, you've always got to be ready to preach. You've always got to be ready to be in the pulpit. If no one turns up, can you get up and can you preach at the drop of a hat? Can you give the gospel straight away? And really that's true with you Christians. You should be ready all the time. At any point someone asks about your faith, you should be able to give an answer to your faith, the scripture says. So let's just look at this. First of all, he says, preach the word, preach the word. The word preach is what we do, and the word is what we preach. Yeah, makes sense. The word preach is kaduzo, and it means to proclaim or to publish. It really refers to a herald. When a king would enter a city many years ago, before he would enter the city, he would send in the herald, and the herald would tell everyone, the king's on his way, everyone get prepared. And there were, sometimes it would be so extreme that they would send the herald in, and the herald would make sure that the city's ready for him. So that people would clean up their gardens, and people would make sure that the road was nice and smooth. We was talking about this week in college, because we was talking about John the Baptist. In the Old Testament it tells us, prepare ye the way of the Lord, you've heard the passage. And it does say in Matthew 3:3, make his paths straight. That's what a herald does. He makes his pathway straight. In the olden days, he would come in on a chariot, and the last thing you want is a bobbly road. As he's coming in, waving to everyone, bobbling all over the place. You know, he's there to make sure that he has a smooth come through the city. And so we know from these epistles that Timothy is called to be the preacher, but we know that Timothy was timid. Paul keeps talking about his timidness, telling him that you've got to be bolder, you've got to be stronger in the faith. And the sad thing is for Timothy, he's finding himself in one of the most fiercest places in that part of the world, which is Ephesus. And we only have to look so far in the Bible and we see that Ephesus had many, many problems. False teachers coming into the church, attacks from without the church, attacks from within the church. And Timothy's left there with these guys to deal with them. We had people of the Diana cult in Ephesus. We had the unbelieving Jews that were constantly causing trouble. And you have the Epicurean philosophers. The Apostle Paul had struggles with all of these people in that city. And now he's left this young man, Timothy, to deal with this. But he's still commanded to preach. It's never to be compromised. I know it goes against natural man to upset people. We want to be welcomed by everyone. We want to be accepted by everyone. But he's saying you've got to preach. You can't compromise what your call is. In 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 5, we read about Noah. And it says, but save Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness. You know, we've been going through the book of Genesis. We're going to get there. And he preached for 120 years. No converts apart from his own family. No converts. But he didn't stop preaching. He didn't stop trying. He kept preaching the word. Jonah didn't want to do the preaching. You remember then God got him swallowed up and spat out on the beach. And you remember he went to Nineveh. And in Jonah chapter 3 verse 2 he says, arise, go unto Nineveh, that great city, and preach unto it the preaching that I bid thee. It wasn't popular. And the Christian faith is never meant to be popular. And the gospel message is not always going to be accepted. In fact, the scripture tells us in most cases it's not going to be. You know, I was just listening to reading a discussion yesterday on social media, and someone's been asking some questions and about all this lockdown, and people started attacking him. People started, the worst thing was, it was his own father, condemning his faith, calling it fairy tales in the public eye. But we're to expect that. We're to expect that. In Mark 16:15, it tells us that we're commanded to do it as well. Preach the word, he says. Go you into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, everybody. Don't worry about the outcome. Just leave that to God. So what does Paul mean when he says preach? We know what preach means, but he says preach the word. What's the word? Well, we know what the word is. It's the word of God. He says in these two books, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16 and 17, we looked at it a couple of weeks ago. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. That's what we're talking about. We're talking about all scripture. No compromise. That we just preach the word of God. He goes on to say in 2 Timothy 2:15, he says, study to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. That's what we're dealing with, the word of God. He goes on and says, hold fast to the form of sound words, 2 Timothy 13, which thou hast heard of me in faith and love, which is in Christ Jesus. All scripture, he says, is the Old Testament, because that's all they had. Apart from the writings of Paul and perhaps some of the Gospels, and that's why he says, hold fast to the form of sound words which thou hast heard of me. So he had some of Paul's writings as well. And he was saying, that's what you preach. You preach the word of God. Don't preach your words. Don't give your arguments. Just preach God's word. Amen. Talking. And so this is referring to the whole body of scripture. And he's saying on one hand, hold fast to him. In other words, protect him. Keep it safe. I'm always on the defence for God's word. You know, when I saw that online, I wanted to say something, but I don't go in those things. I know they don't look good when you start arguing with people. But when someone asks a question, I want to answer the question. I always try to answer questions. This week at Bible College, I was just getting bombarded with questions. And it was good. I enjoy it. We was talking about Jesus, and you remember in the Old Testament, it says there was nothing physically that would attract us to him, in Isaiah 52. And I kind of put my foot in it because someone says to me, he said, does that mean that the Bible says that some people are pretty and some people are ugly? And I says, yeah. I said, take for example, Sarah. The Bible says she's beautiful. And as I says that, Sarah lifted up her head and no one else could see her. And I said, not you, Sarah. No, I said, Sarah, this is why the scripture says, let not many of you be masters, because we talk too much and we put our foot in the table. Lauren just rolled her eyes at me. We preach the word. We give it out. We're not just to hold it, the scripture says, and treasure it. That's true. We hold it. We protect it. But we're to preach it and we're to share it as well. You know, there's many preachers out there, but not many of them are preaching the word. They're telling them stories. They're giving analogies all the time. There's nothing wrong with that. There's a time, there's a place. But we've got to preach the word. It's the word that makes the difference. Romans 10, verse 13 and 14, for whosoever shall call upon the name shall be saved. How then shall they call on him whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? We're to preach, and we're to preach the word, and when we preach, they're hearing the word of God. Verse 17, the same chapter, so then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. We're to preach the word of God. And that's what the Great Commission is. The Great Commission is that you go out and you preach the gospel, the word of God. Remember we looked at Mark, it says preach to every creature. In Matthew it says to teach all nations, a completely different word. So not only we preach, we proclaim it, but we also teach it. And then he says teaching them to observe all things, and that's another word. It means disciple them. We are preaching and teaching to make disciples. You know, this is one of the reasons I like to preach expositionally, verse by verse. Because that's how the word is written. It's written that way. Now I understand every so often we have to go off on a topic here and there. But I like to come back to these things. I like to go through the Bible verse by verse. And I want to tell you why it's important, I believe, to preach the word like this. And I'm going to give you a list of things. First of all, it lets God speak and not man. The preacher is just the voice of God. If we're preaching verse by verse, if we're preaching the scriptures verse by verse, that means God's speaking to you. Because God's putting it in the order that he put it. And it's not me anymore. I'll give you a second one. When you dig deeply into the scriptures, you're digging deeply into the mind of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You're getting to understand the way that God thinks. The order that God put it down. And so you'll know what's true and what's false. You know, for me, this is an incredible experience. When I study the word, I love studying the word. I absolutely love it. It's exhilarating for me. And you know, sometimes when I'm studying the word, I just want to be there and I don't want it to stop. I get up in the mornings and I start studying the word, and Lorraine will shout me and she'll say, your breakfast is ready. And I love my breakfast. But sometimes I just don't want it to stop. Same when I prepare on a Sunday morning for service. You know, comes about 8:30 and the kids get up and then the noise starts. No, but I want to be there. And I'm not saying that these things aren't important, because they are. But when I'm in God's word, it's like my head's in the heavenlies. I'm being blessed by God. I'm in fellowship with God on another level. So when you're preaching like this, verse by verse, you're bringing the mind of God to the people. Many preachers want to say little about God's word and spend the rest of the time telling stories. And I know we all tell stories. I told you one at the very start. But really, for me, to get to the crux of it, I want to speak the word of God. I want to tell you what the word of God says. And this is why I love Bible College. You know, when I tell people I teach at the Bible College and I've got a full-time job, and they go, are you mad? You need to do that? But I love it. It makes it even more beneficial when I've got students that want to listen, that want to study. You know, I've spent an entire week teaching one student. It doesn't bother me. I'm not bothered how many turn up. For me, what's important is that they've turned up to study God's word, because I want to help people. I want to strengthen people in the faith.
Amen.
I love preaching the word. I love teaching the word. I'll give you another reason. Expository preaching reveals everything about God and his word. It gives us all the details. You've seen me. I can preach two sermons on a verse. And I can stretch it even further than that. I've been going with Jamie through the leadership qualities of a pastor. And we're on week 7, and we've done about 3 verses. But that is the way it goes. Because there's so much there. There's so much in God's word. And no matter how many times you read it, no matter how many times you study the word of God, you cannot exhaust it. It's just blessing after blessing. I usually say when I teach about the Bible in theology, I've got many books in my library. And I'll give them away. Because once I've read them once, I don't need to read them again. But the Bible just keeps me thirsty. It keeps me hungry. And it feeds me every day. And that's why the scripture talks in the Psalms that to meditate on his laws night and day. I love every detail of it. I love thinking about it. I love reading about it. I love talking about it. I love studying. Another reason you should do this is that when you preach this way, you don't jump nothing. You don't miss nothing out. You hit everything. And I believe every word is there because God said it's got to be there. You know, we were saying this week that Abraham's seed, remember that passage, was the promise. And Paul said in Galatians, not seeds, seed. He even says the singular of a word is important. Every single detail. But this also means that you preach and you convict your own heart as well. You preachers understand this, that when you sit down and you start to study the word of God and you're in that state of mind and you're preparing this and thinking this is going to be marvellous for the people, they're going to love this. And before you know it, you're browbeating yourself with the word of God, because God is convicting you through the word. And it's also a way that you deal with issues in the church. That's why we preach expositionally. That's why we preach in context in our church. Because we sometimes need to deal with issues. But guess what? You can't accuse us for preaching just to deal with that issue. Because we're going from verse to verse. And we're not doing it on purpose. I might be preaching something now and it might be hitting you. And I don't know who you are. But it's the word of God. And I say this, I mean, I think there's a time to apply sometimes preaching in the pulpit where we should address an issue in the church. But by and large, a lot of the time, we're just preaching what God's put upon our heart. And we're letting the Holy Spirit do the rest. Let me give you another reason. Preaching the word means that it promotes biblical literacy. You know, our goal as preachers, we want you to know the scriptures. There's no hierarchical system here where we have the mysteries and you need to pay us some money so we can reveal some to you. You know, we want you to know. We want people to be biblically literate. You know, sometimes I even look at my own sermons and I think, have I put too much Bible in there? But you really can't. I can't do it any other way. You know, I've had students give me papers and I can tell when they're struggling to write a paper because they start filling it up with things. And instead of putting references, Bible references, like just the reference itself, they start to fill the paper up with Bible verses and double spacing them and, you know, all those things. But, you know, my word, my sermons, I have to put them together in such a way. And God just speaks to me. And it's just the word of God. And so I see sometimes people in the audience get a little bit tiresome when I'm saying this verse, and they're flicking through the Bibles. I remember the days when we didn't have the digital stuff and everyone flicked through their Bibles, and it was a good sight to see because it kind of told us who's listening and who isn't, because people would flick through their Bibles. And that's why sometimes I'll break it up a little bit with humour. You know, when I'd say things like dirty Bible, clean Christian. I'm just trying to break it up. I understand that sometimes as we're going through the scriptures and there's verse on top of verse on top of verse, But what we're trying to do is make you biblically literate. You know, this week at the Bible College, over and over again, we went through the Old Testament. They didn't realize that I was doing that. I don't think so anyway, but I kept cycling through the Old Testament. We looked at the geography of the land. We looked at the biblical empires of that time. They all went to sleep on the geography part of the time. But then we started looking at all the covenants in the Bible. We went through again. Looked at the dispensations of the Bible. We went through again. Then we looked at the books of the Bible. We went through again. And why do we keep doing this? Because we want people to be biblically literate. You need to know your book. It's your book. You need to believe what you believe. Let me give you another reason we preach the word. It's because it carries authority. It not only helps people to understand, but it's the word of God. It compels people to act. It's not just me giving you a clever argument to get you not to live in sin anymore, or to be backslidden anymore, or to move on to the next part of your spiritual life anymore. My arguments are not going to do that. But God's word will. That's why we preach on the word, because God's word is powerful and it will cause change. And finally, it transforms the preacher. As I've said, when I study, it transforms me, it works on me. When I was preparing this morning, it was making me think, perhaps I haven't been doing what I should have been doing. And it happens all the time with me. That as I'm studying God's word, God is speaking directly to me. And you know, when you have a transformed preacher, that will show in his preaching. And when you have transformed preaching, it should show in the congregation. It should filter down to you. And that's why we're looking at this passage. I'm really saying to you that you should hold us accountable for what we teach and preach. You, as a congregation, you expect the best. And if you don't expect the best, you're not going to get the best. And if you don't get the best, then you're probably not going to live up to the standard yourself. So a faithful minister then should understand the seriousness of the mission. God is watching all the time. But secondly, the content of the mission. You've been called to preach the word. And let me say again, it doesn't end just with a preacher. As Christians, remember, the Great Commission is for everybody. You have been called to do the same. You have a field of your own to preach on. It's your family. It's your relatives. It's the people that you work with. These are the people that you should be preaching to. People have this idea that you have to go out and stand on the corner and preach sermons. You know, the Old Testament actually says Jesus didn't do that. He preached in synagogues, he preached in the temple, and he preached to his people. He didn't actually street preach. He went to the synagogues. But that doesn't necessarily mean that we have to go out. I'm not saying that we shouldn't, because we should. But there's many ways that we can reach the people that we love. Many ways. I mean, we have moms and tots. We have coffee mornings. I know that you invite people into church in your life. So the third point. A faithful minister, first of all, we said, should understand the seriousness of his mission. Secondly, the content of his mission. And thirdly, you must understand the extent of his mission. Look at verse 2. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. And he says this, be instant. We'll start with that. Just two words in English, but one in Greek, epistema. It means to be ready, to be at hand. Military-wise, it means to assault. It has the idea that he's always on watch. There's no hours off for the preacher. There's no days off. He works a 24-hour clock. That at any point, he's ready. He's ready for anything. And I'll tell you something now. I mean, I'm only, 10, 15 years into my ministry, and already I thought that I'd saw it all. And you never get to the stage where you've seen it all. Nothing seems to surprise you anymore, the things that you'll see. But you've still got to be ready. You've got to be ready all the time. I sometimes, I'm not advising that you do this, by the way, but I get messages in the early hours of the morning, last thing at night, first thing as soon as I wake up, I have messages waiting for me sometimes for advice. I have people phoning me at inconvenient times. Guess what I have to do? As a minister, I have to answer. I have to be ready. I have to be ready to answer the call. And that's what he's saying. He's saying you've got to be instant, you've got to be ready. And Paul is saying to Timothy, there should be no hesitation or reluctance to preach the word or the gospel at any time. Whenever you have the opportunity, do it. And I know that we fail sometimes, even I do it, where there's an opportunity where I could have done some service and I didn't do it. But this is saying we should be ready all the time to serve God. The opportunity arises. The Apostle Paul understood what it meant to face the challenge from men to stop him from preaching. Because that's one of the reasons we don't do it, because we fear people. The reason we won't go out, or the reason we won't witness sometimes or act upon what God puts on our heart to do, is because we fear the consequences of men. What people might say, or what people might do. And the Apostle Paul understood this. In Acts chapter 21, verses 10 and 11, you remember there was a man called Agabus. And the prophet, told Paul that if he went to Jerusalem, they would bend him hand and foot. They would arrest him, and they would hand him over to the Gentiles. He prophesied that it was going to happen, because he was going to go to Jerusalem. Look at the response of the Christian church, 21:12. And when we heard these things, both we and they, that place, besought him not to go to Jerusalem. They said, don't go. Don't get going, Paul. Because they're going to arrest you. They're going to lose their Apostle Paul. He's not going to be able to come and visit our churches anymore. He's going to be put in prison. And notice there as well, it says, and we heard. That's Luke. Luke was one of them. Luke, the man that stood to the very end. We're going to see him in 2 Timothy chapter 4. Luke was one of them, said, don't go. And we wouldn't want that, would we? You know, if we knew Pastor Gritz was going to go to Cannock and he was going to get arrested, and sorry, Cannock people. We would say, don't go. We don't want to lose you. But look what Paul says in verse 13. Paul answered, what mean ye to weep and to break my heart? For I am ready not to be bound only, but also to die at Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. I'll die doing what I'll do, he says. Nothing's going to stop me. And why are you doing this? You're breaking my heart. You're trying to get me to stay when this is where I need to go. And it didn't stop there. Look at verse 14. And when he would not be persuaded, in other words, they carried on. Even when he says, stop doing this, I'm going, they carried on trying to persuade Paul, you need to stay. It says, eventually, though, we see saying, and then it says, the will of the Lord be done. The will of the Lord be done. And Paul was just ready. He was ready all the time to preach and to do God's will. Ephesians 5:16 says that you should be as well. Look what it says. Redeeming the time, because the days are evil. You should be the same. It literally means buy up the time. Make the most of what you have, serving the Lord. Because the days are evil. In other words, life is short. And there's going to come a time when we might not be able to do it as freely as we are. And so you've got to make sure that you're busy and serving God and that nothing stops you. But then he says this, be instant, in other words, be ready, in season and out of season, when it's convenient and when it's not convenient, when people want to hear it and when people don't want to hear it. In other words, nothing will constrain you to talk about God. You don't care if you offend people, upset people. You're not doing it to offend people, but you're doing it because you love people. But you'll preach the truth anyway, whether people get upset or not. Literally nothing should silence you as a Christian for speaking up for God. You know, when I conduct funerals sometimes, I've literally had this where someone has asked me to do a funeral and they've pretty much told me we don't want none of the God stuff in. And I've said, what have you called me for? If I can't put some of the God stuff in, I don't want to do it at all. And eventually they gave in. When I teach about funerals, what happens when you come to do a funeral of an unbeliever? Well, we sneak it in, don't worry. We always sneak that gospel in. We always do. Be instant in season and out season. And so what does it really come down to is that he's not swayed to be changed. Nothing's going to change me. I'm going to preach whether people love it or whether people hate it, whether people are saved or whether they're not, I'm going to carry on preaching, and you should as well. You should carry on testifying of your faith. And then he kind of tells us the details of preaching. And first of all, he gives us a negative. Look what he says, reprove and rebuke. Now, we're still talking about the preaching. He talks about the two sides. There's a negative side here, and there's a positive side. Firstly, the negative is reprove and rebuke. Reprove has to do with the mind, right? It reveals what's wrong. It means to refute error. You know, in other words, you're trying to convert people to come to Scripture. And rebuke has to do with the heart. It's to do with conviction. So first, you disclose the sinfulness of sin, and then you disclose the sinfulness of the sinner. You tell them the truth, and the whole purpose of it is the Holy Spirit goes to work on the sinner and convicts them of the errors of their life. Jesus did it all the time, constantly reproved people. No, I'm not saying that God isn't love. The Scripture makes it very clear God is love. But you know, Jesus preached very little on the love of God. He preached a lot about sin, and about the sinfulness of man, and about the need of a Saviour. It was very offensive. excuse me, John the Baptist did the same. You remember he spoke to Herod. And what did he say to Herod? God so loved you that he gave his only son. No, he didn't do that. He says, you have been sleeping with your brother's wife. He reproved him. He got him thrown in prison. And eventually got him beheaded. Did he compromise? No, he didn't compromise. So there's a negative aspect to preaching. That when you preach, you rebuke people. And the way you rebuke people is through the word of God. So it's not me judging you. It's God's word that's convicting. And that's where the next bit comes in. But there's a positive side here. Because look what it says, exhort. And the word is paracleia. You know the word that means come alongside them. Correct them. Tell them they're wrong. But then help them. Come alongside them. The preacher confronts their sin. And then encourages them out of it. Talks them out of it. Look where it's going to lead. Look where it's going to go. But what you need to do is you need to come to the Lord. But then we see some more positive. He says, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. You know, long-suffering, it means patience. It doesn't mean patience in ministry. It means patience with people. It needs a person, patience with people. You confront sin, you rebuke the sinner, you encourage the recovery, and then you just can't believe how long it takes. It takes a long time. Thank you. Did you hear that? You confront the sin, you rebuke the sinner, you encourage the recovery, and then you just can't believe how long it takes. You know, sometimes it is hard. When you preach and you preach, especially, you're trying to put across, most of the time in preaching, the same message. And you've got to find different ways of saying the same things over and over again so that people will listen. And that gets difficult. But it's even more difficult when people won't listen. When people won't change. The word is makothamia, and it means you never get bitter. You never get irritated at people. Exasperated, annoyed. You never mean spirited towards them. Why? Look, if I'm trying to put together a good argument for you not to live the way that you're living, then obviously I'm offended because it's my argument that you're against. But I'm not doing that. I'm called to preach the word, to preach truth. And if you don't want to respond, then that's between you and God. Then that's what God, you know, this is where we start to pray, God, do something. And trust me, you don't want us to be praying those prayers. Because guess what God does? He does something. And sometimes it's not the best of things. Chastisement isn't nice. You know, it's one of the hardest things to do as a minister is just to be patient and to wait on God and just see what the Lord is doing. Really, a spirit of grace is what's needed when you're doing this sort of preaching, which is one of the fruits of the Spirit. And finally, a positive again, long-suffering, and then he says doctrine. Didache, teaching. It means to teach the word. Like I said earlier on, is that I've taught you quite a lot, and Pastor Gritz and Danny, over the years. And eventually we run out of material, and we have to study again, and study again, and study again, and study again. And it does get monotonous. There is a monotony about preaching. There's a monotony about living the Christian life sometimes, doing the same things over and over again. But that's what we're called to do. We're called to carry on. No matter how hard it is, we just carry on doing what we should be doing. And so he says, we preach, we proclaim the truth, no matter what people think. We proclaim not only the truth, we proclaim the word. We preach the word of God, Old Testament and the New Testament. You've got to become biblically literate Christians. You've got to know what the Bible teaches. I can't emphasize that enough. And I see it so often when I ask questions about, what do you know about the Bible? And people don't understand. Even sometimes the simplest things of your faith. He says, preach the word, be instant. Be ready all the time to give an answer, to give a defense of the faith. He says, in season and out of season, whether people will like it or whether people don't, reprove them. In other words, talk to people about their sin, rebuke them, let the Holy Spirit go to work, exhort them, come alongside them, help them to come back to God with long suffering. Be patient with them. Be patient. And he says, and teach. Some good qualities there, isn't there? Some good things to learn from. Like I said, this isn't just about me, it's about you. Is that really what you expect of the preacher? Is that what you expect of the preacher? But more importantly, is it what you expect of yourself? These things are important for you. You should be out there preaching as well. You should be studying to show yourself approved. You should be getting to know the scriptures very well. You should be willing to speak to people even if they're going to reject you. You should be willing to walk alongside your brothers and sisters if they need you. That's what we're all called to do. You know, I'm thankful for what God's given me so far in my life. The ministry, the service that I do. I'm happy. I know it's hard sometimes, but I'm happy. Can you say that about your own life? As a Christian, are you happy with what you're doing for God? Have you come to the point where you're stagnant and you're not doing anything for God? Because you know yourself, because I know myself, when God speaks to me and puts things on my heart, and we go, no. I don't want to do those things. You know, God speaks to us all as Christians, and he puts things on our heart to do, but we've got to act upon them. That's where bliss is as a Christian, true happiness. Like we had that last lockdown for the first 2 weeks, I was in a mess. I'd become the sloth of the Proverbs, like a door turning up on its hinges on my bed, because ministry had been snatched from underneath me. And so what do? I find it. I go out and see what I can do. I reach out to people. But you need to do the same. You need to find where it is that God wants you. Amen. And you need to be living faithfully in that. Yeah. I know with this lockdown now, new things have come, and it could mean that some ministries have been snatched from us. But let's look what we can do next.
Amen.
There's always a plan B.
Yes.
Let's pray. Father, we just thank you for your word. That letter to Timothy, Lord, even so small as it is, Lord, rich in blessing it is. And we just thank you for it. And Lord, I just pray now if there's someone here now struggling with the way that their Christian life is and their service to you. Lord, we know that your word makes it very clear what we should be doing. Makes it very clear. Lord, that we need to submit ourselves to you and just give ourselves up. It doesn't matter what people think. It doesn't matter what people are going to say. What matters is what you think. I'm not going to stand in their courtroom. I'm going to stand in your courtroom. crossroads. And so I pray, Lord, today for someone here that's not doing right, not living the way they should, not giving their life over to you in the manner that they should. Lord, that you could speak to their hearts today. Lord, that they don't leave this building without talking to someone or without talking to you, Lord, and just putting those things right. Lord, I pray for those at home as well, Lord, the people that can't come to church for whatever reason. I just ask that you can be with them. And Lord, help them at this time. Lord, that even at home we can find ministries, we can find things to do to encourage people, to strengthen people, to disciple, to witness, to evangelize. So many different things we can do. So I just ask, Lord, that you can put these things upon our hearts and help us to act upon them. Lord, we know that if there's something good to do and we don't do, we know that's sin. So I just pray that we don't get unbusy during this next month, Lord. Lord, we become busier. We become closer to you.